Hello and welcome. I am Dr. Anil Joshi, Professor of Radiology. We are going to discuss today a topic that is evaluation of male urethra by retrograde urethrography. It will be shortly spelled as RGU and it will be referred in this full lecture series as only as RGU for simplicity. On this topic, I had three publications. The first publication has come as the analytical study of stricture urethra by retrograde pyelography. It was published in an international journal and it is available in our website as well as any other thing. The second article was over the case of duplication of urethra. That was also published in an international journal. And the third article was comparing retrograde urethrography findings with intraoperative findings in stricture urethra. In that, what we have done is we have analyzed, we have performed the retrograde urethrography studies in a suspected cases of urethral pathologies, and subsequently, when the cases were operated, we have compared the findings of retrograde urethrography RGU with the operative findings, and that was mainly to know what is the accuracy of these studies. Now, let's get started over the topic, that is today's lecture topic. It is the RGU. We are going to see first the theoretical aspect and then we are going to see a couple of cases and we'll know how to interpret them. So let us come to a first introduction. Several imaging modalities are available for visualization of stricture urethra, such as retrograde urethrography, magnetic resonance urethrography, sonourethrography. We have conducted the studies in our department regarding sonourethrography. The results are comparable, but the acceptance for RGU, that is with using the contrast, is much more by the surgeons. So we are continuing with the same method. Now, RGU is baseline imaging modality for evaluation of urethral diseases, since urethral anatomy is well visualized by the study. Retrograde urethrography is considered to be the best initial study or the investigation of choice when we are getting any patients of perineal injuries, urethral stricture injuries, and other indication which we are going to see in detail once we are going to proceed in the lecture. Therefore, at present, retrograde urethrography is investigation of choice in suspected cases of stricture, urethra, and bladder trauma. Because before putting catheter in any patient where suspected injury is for the bladder or for the urethra, RGU must be done to know the mapping of the bladder, urethra. Now, clinical presentation, how these patients present? As we have seen, the chronic voiding symptoms like dribbling of urine. Second is dysuria, poor stream, staining and feeling of incomplete evaluation are the suspicion for first initial studies ultrasound. So these patients are first referred for ultrasound, and from there, when they are suspected to have bladder outlet obstruction, that is BWO, patients are referred to RGU. Now, prior to surgery, for anatomical roadmap and pathological diagnosis are required by the surgeons. And acute obstruction cases, there is emergency and need, and whenever catheterization is needed, RGU is done before to know whether the retention is true or it is just a anuria which is presenting like bladder outlet obstruction. Now, clinician therefore, before starting the treatment, needs information regarding location, length and severity of the strictures. And we feel investigation of choice is again RGU. Now, how this investigation is conducted? Now, we have to explain this patient how the procedure is done. First, we assure him that it is totally a painless procedure. So there are no pain, there is no pain during the investigation, except sometimes patient gets stretching sensation. So he is explained in detail how we are going to perform the procedure. The risk of radiation, of course, is negligible, but needs to be informed. Then risk of contrast, again, it is negligible since we are using non-ionic contrast, since it has to be informed. And third, instrumental damage to the urinary tract. The technique which you are using, equipment which we are using, this possibility is extremely rare. We'll know it when we are doing the technical aspect and the procedure detail as we proceed in the lecture. Immediate as well as delayed contrast reactions are explained to the patient. Immediate, we are there to take care, but once patient goes home, he is instructed which are likely to be delayed reactions. However, with the same technique we are using, instrument like 8 number fitting tube, due to use of non-ionic contrast, we again emphasize the risk is negligible. Now, examination startup, that is means we have taken the consent, patient is referred after ultrasound, we are suspecting BWO, bladder outlet obstruction. So, we have instructed patient, we have given him clear area. Now, what is the next? Next is patient instructed to empty his bladder. Before the procedure, AP film is opted as a scour film. Now, the only difference is here, we see that urethra is included in AP film. But nowadays, we have got 14 by 17 film, so that is not a big problem. It should be included. So, AP film is taken as a scour film. Foreskin of patient is pulled back. Foreskin of patient is pulled back and tip of the penis and surrounding area is cleaned with antiseptic solution. We use here Betadine, Cevnon and other antiseptic solutions. So after it is cleaned with antiseptic solution, again little bit Betadine is put to the tip of the penis. A small amount of local anesthesia is optional, but we feel that it prevents spasm. So what we do is we take 2 ml syringe, we fill it with local contrast, that is lignocaine gel, and we introduce into the urethra before doing the procedure. And we found that this gives a better result because the pain because of stretching is much less with this local anesthetic agent. Now it also helps to relax the sphincter as a patient may constrict it during the examination. And if patient constrict his external sphincter, there are some fallacies on the RGU films. Now, patient position should be oblique to visualize full length. Single oblique versus multiple oblique in different angulations. We use this second method. Every time when one exposure is complete and we go for second exposure, we make patient slightly more angulate. Now, what happens is the prostatic urethra, membranous urethra, is obscured by the symphysis pubis. In this obliquity, that is separated from it and it is clearly seen. So what we do is patient is positioned into the radiography table in right or left oblique position, and while the opposite leg, one of the leg needs to be flexed from the knee. Now penis is placed laterally over the thigh. The tip of the metallic adapter or fitting tube. Our at present practice is to use a fitting tube. We do not need any metallic catheters. That is placed in the orifice. Now, only thing we have to take care is the fitting tube has got slightly proximal openings. So that care has to be taken that the dye will come out not from the tip but from the sides. The contrast is loaded in a 50 ml syringe. That is 20 ml non-ionic contrast. It is diluted in a distal water or normal saline. We prefer saline in our studies. And this 50 ml syringe is taken in the hand. It is connected to the fitting tube and the contrast is injected. Ideal images demonstrate the entire length of urethra with contrast beginning to fill from the bladder. So what we see is the entire penile urethra, then comes is the bulbous urethra, then comes is the membranous urethra, prostate urethra, and then the bladder. We take totally 3 to 4 films. So either of the film shows the dye is going or streaming into the bladder. So that is the one criteria which tells us study is complete. Now what are the complications? Complications, as we have said, are related to contrast. Complications are related to procedural techniques and the delay complication and the immediate complication. Let us go one after another. The contrast reaction is due to absorption of contrast to the bladder mucosa. It's slow, so they come late. They come not as a severe reactions, and we have not observed this in any of the studies we have conducted. Urinary tract infection is a theoretical complication. Patient comes with urinary tract infection. One of the cause of urinary tract infection is a BWO, bladder outlet obstruction. Now, same infection can get flared. So, many advising doctors prefer patient should be covered with antibiotics. Then, urethral trauma is a theoretical complication which we don't really come across or we don't see. It's a very simple procedure. Then, intravasation of contrast. is more commonly seen in patients where the recent catheterization has been done. So it's the excess pressure when we use, then it can get into exacerbation of the, there is any recent catheterization. The anatomy of the urinary bladder. Now, anatomy of the urinary bladder, we should know, because we are going to see from urethra, prostate, urethra, bladder, neck. So for that, some anatomy of bladder should be known. It's a distensible muscular organ located within the pelvic cavity. Okay. Posterior to the symphysis pubis and inferior to parietal peritoneum. Now, size of the bladder varies. However, the upper border of bladder should not rise above the level of lumbosacral junction, that is L5-S1. In child and the second or third sacral segment of the adult, it can reach. Now, normal bladder wall thickness is 2 to 3 mm in fully distended bladder. Now, let us come to the anatomy of urethra. Female urethra 3 to 4 cm, we are not going to cover because that is not the topic of today's lecture. Now, male urethra is 20 cm long. The prostate urethra is approximately 3 cm in length. We are starting from bladder downward. It passes through the prostatic gland. So obviously, whatever are the pathologies of prostate will be reflected on this urethra. If there is any enlargement of the prostatic gland, first it will compress the urethra. The membranous urethra is approximately 1 cm. It passes through the urogenital diaphragm. So that is the second portion, that is membranous urethra. Third is bulbar urethra. Bulbar urethra passes from anterior aspect of urogenital diaphragm to penosacral junction. So that is the bulbar urethra. And last is the penile urethra, what we usually commonly say as, it is also called as spongy urethra. It passes through the length of the penis. So it is usually longest segment of the urethra. The anterior urethra is extended from its origin and ends at the membranous urethra. This is the classification of urethra, anterior urethra and posterior urethra. So anterior urethra extends from the origin and ends at the urethra to the urethral meatus. So urethral meatus till it goes to the tip of the penis. Then it is divided into bulbar, segmental and penile. So these are the three portions of it. There is usually mild angulation of the urethra where these two segments join at the penoscrotal junction. Now where there is a junction, there is an angulation. Contraction or spasm of the constrictor nudi, there is a muscle which you are going to see also in the films where it causes a compression. It's a deep musculotendinous ring of the bulbocavernous muscle. It may cause anterior or less frequently a circumstantial indentation over the proximal bulbous urethra. Now this bulbous urethra indentation should not be confused with the stricture urethra. Now filling of the corpus duct should not be misinterpreted as extravasation. Now what are the sphincters of urethra? There is internal sphincter, then there is an external sphincter. Now internal sphincter is voluntary in nature. It is supplied by sympathetic nerves and it controls the neck of the bladder and prostatic urethra together. Then what is the external urethral sphincter? It's a voluntary in nature, supplied by perineal branch of the pudendal nerve, and it controls the membranous urethra and it is responsible for the voluntary pulling. Now here we are seeing division of the anterior and posterior urethra. These important terms of pathology and imaging the urethra. The comparison of MCU and RGU are given here. Now first film is MCU and second film is RGU. Now what happens if you see or compare these two? In MCU, bladder is better visualized, while in RGU, it's partially visualized. Now coming to urethra. The prostatic urethra is always better visualized with MCU and it is not as good visualized in the, or it is not as good in the distension of it, not as much in RGU. Now penile urethra is more distended in the retrograde passage, while it is less distended in the MCU because the flowing state goes out. Now bladder stones can be detected by RGU. We are seeing a couple of cases in which I will be showing you that they are seen, but it is not more or less an indication. Bladder stone is not an indication for MCU. It's an incidental finding in MCU. Most are a mixture of calcium oxalate and calcium phosphate. So these are the two things which causes it. or which are the constituents of it. Then primarily the bladder stones forming, we know in the bladder. So primary stones, they form in the bladder, and secondary they drop from the kidney. So the production is somewhere in the kidney, and from there they drop into the bladder. Now third is the what causes bladder stone is a stasis, that is bladder outlet obstruction. Then neurogenic bladder, because the urine stays there for a long time, if there are any minus, the calcium can be laid down around it. Then also causes like foreign bodies, sometimes around the catheter also we see the bladder stones are formed. Now here we are seeing the indication for RGU is a revision, urethral stricture, pelvic trauma, urethral foreign bodies, urethral diverticulum, periurethral prostatic abscesses, fistula, false passage, urethral mucosal tumors, post-operative evaluation of the urethra. Then what are the contraindications? Absolute contraindication is relative. Acute UTI, again it's a relative contraindication. Then recent urethral instrumentation. Now if it is done, there are more chances that there will be intravasation, or if there are any false passages, it will be demonstrated. Then hypersensitivity to contrast, the patient tells us before. So that is a contraindication. Now we are seeing here two films, anterior urethra, posterior urethra. Now the contrast medium is injected and films are taken in the upper film, and lower is the diagrammatic presentation. Now last is the filming tape. Now what are the urethral traumas? Urethral trauma, it is indicated because before putting a catheter, you should know whether there is rupture or not. Otherwise, it can cause a severe complication. So any bladder or urethral trauma patient, RGU has to be done before passing a catheter. Now, what is the classification? Is anterior, the anterior and posterior urethral injuries. As we have seen the urethral segments, anterior segment and posterior segments, these are the two veins where the urethral traumas are. Now, what is the role of urethrography in a stricture urethra? I again request you to go to our original article where it is elaborately illustrated the cases and the incidence rate and all theoretical possibilities. Now, let us enumerate it again, role of urethrography in stricture urethra. It accurately delineates the anatomy of urethra. Location, number, extent of the strictures can be well seen by RGU. Then these can be very well displayed. So you will be seeing it on the film by which I can see, somebody else can see, surgeons can see. Then delineation of the bladder, neck and urethra is best by these techniques. Then achieved on the MCU in the oblique projection. These all details you can achieve by MCU in an oblique projection. Then secondary changes of the bladder can also be delineated. Then it can demonstrate VOR. We are going to see a film where we have demonstrated it. But for VOR, RGU is not an investigation of choice. It's an incidental finding which we are getting here, and visualization of any other fistula. If there are any, they can be seen. Now, information sought in radiographic investigation. What are the information we get? Like the site of the pathology. Second is number of pathologies. One stricture, two stricture, or multiple stricture. The length of the stricture can be directly measured. Then severity, mild, moderate, or it is near total. Then severity is again mild, moderate, or it is twice. Then associated anomalies. In associated anomalies, more we are thinking of the prostate. The enlarged prostate causes indentation over the bladder base. Then these are the common organisms which can cause stricture urethra. Like infection, gonococcal urethritis is top of the list, and non-gonococcal urethritis are also there. Then there are multiple other causative organisms and causative reasons which you can go through. Now common causes of urethral stricture include congenital are extremely uncommon, but they can be still seen. Usual posterior urethral wall are followed by, or they can be isolated. Then not to be confused with posterior urethral walls. Now there is a circumscribed type of posterior urethral wall. They should not be mistaken, or it's sometimes really difficult to differentiate these two. This variety of posterior urethral valves and stricture urethra. Then gonorrhea remains as the most common sexually transmitted disease. Nowadays, because of good antibiotics and early detection, gonorrhea leading to stricture urethra, we are getting less and less cases. Then urethra strictures are less common, as I said, in any of the infection of urethra, because we treat them immediately, we detect them immediately. The instrument related are still there. The instrument related comes for a catheterization, and they are strictures are usually occurring in membranous urethra and less commonly in a Peno or Stotal junction. Now here we are going to see RGU versus MCU. Generally a RGU or ascending urography is carried out to visualize anterior urethral abnormalities and voiding or MCU for posterior urethral abnormalities. Posterior urethral abnormalities mainly are the prostatic urethral abnormalities, bladder abnormalities, bladder neck abnormalities and the reflux. Additionally, though the bladder is not generally the main target of examination, as with the cystura, a MCU can be useful in detection of bladder abnormalities and vesicular reflux. And in our study, what we have shown is, if stricture urethra is very tight, to visualize urethra proximal to it, towards bladder side, we have to do a MCU. From that, there are different ways of putting dye into the bladder. One thing is direct puncture, second is following IVB, that can be done. So these are the methods by which a dye can be put into the bladder, and this examination can be, MCU can be performed to visualize the proximal urethra. Now we are coming here to our film training session. Theoretically, how a RGU should be performed. Now here we are showing you how a normal scout film is taken. Scout film should include bladder, as we have said, up to lumbosacral junction or up to the umbilicus if you want to know surface marking by radiography. And RGU is performed in an oblique position. Now bladder should be seen, prostate should be seen, membranous urethra, bulbar urethra, then penile urethra and tip of the penis. All these things has to be seen properly in the study you are performing. Now there are pathologies which you can detect in a scout film, like bladder film, what we were saying. You know it before that there is a bladder stone, and lot of the condition when there is a bladder stone, it is associated with urethral abnormality, particularly stricture urethra. Now look at this scout film. The scout film is showing you diastasis and symphysis pubis. Now before starting a procedure, you know this is a case of bladder extrophic, or this could be a case of bladder repaired, maybe second is prune belly syndrome, osteogenesis imperfecta or hypothyroidism. So by and large, none of these conditions are acquired conditions. So you be careful when you see a plain X-ray like this, that there may be associated of these things, and you investigate patient accordingly. Now this is normal RGU. What it is showing? It is showing the parts which I have already explained to you. They are in the diagram what we have shown to you. Now this is post-traumatic patients, as it is seen with the fracture treated. Now what you are seeing here is a proximal urethra. Now so many times we are showing you that there are stricture urethra that will not allow dye to go into the bladder. Now most of the time these patients will be with a self-retaining catheter into the bladder. So it's easy to put little contrast into the bladder and ask patient to avoid, to know the proximal segment. Here you are seeing it, it is a proximal obstruction segment, that is after the prostatic urethra. Prostatic urethra is normal, after prostatic urethra there is obstruction which MCU clearly delineates. Now this is the case of stricture membranous urethra. Both the cases are stricture membranous urethra. Now stricture can be a short, it can be a long segment. It can involve entire penile urethra or it can involve a segment of it. Now here what you are seeing is a long stricture penile urethra, and bladder stone calculus is seen in the scout film. Both are not same patient, they are different patients. Now this is the case of stricture membranous urethra. You are seeing a stricture at membranous urethra, and in second patient you are seeing long stricture of penile urethra. This is what we were discussing, that for reflux, RGU is not an investigation of choice. But in this patient you are seeing it, we are putting a dye through the urethra into the bladder, but the reflex is seen. So incidental finding, and second important thing in this patient is a stricture urethra which we are really interested. So that is seen, stricture urethra. Now this is stricture penile urethra, entire penile urethra. You can note the site, you can note the length, and you can also see that there is a stricture membranous urethra in addition to penile urethra. Now, again, vesical calculus may be seen in plenic sin, or it may be seen as a negative filling defect. Now, that depends on the constituency of the stone, whether it is calcium containing or non-calcium containing. Now, here you are seeing a negative filling defect. Again, it is in favor of a radiolucent calculus. And second, you are seeing is the below stricture membranous urethra. Now, here you are seeing a total stricture bulbous urethra. No dye is going into the bladder. So, what's the next immunization of choice? Is you have to go for MCU to know the proximal segment. So these are the two investigation adjoining to each other. Now this is stricture bulbous membranous urethra and partial stricture penile urethra. So multiple stricture you are seeing of different segments of urethra. Now again here you are seeing stricture bulbous urethra. Sometimes the filling defect in the bladder can be because of the flow defect. That is when the dye is filling the bladder, you can get a deceptive filling defects in the bladder, needs to be confirmed. Now this is again a near total or total stricture bulbar urethra. Now here total stricture bulbar urethra, in another case with multiple stricture adjacent to each other. You should tell me this is total stricture bulbar urethra. This is stricture penile urethra, bulbar urethra. Against different patient, same pathology. Some operating procedure indicates patient is likely to be post-traumatic. No? Bulbar stricture, penile urethra strictures, bulbar urethra again, penile urethra stricture. Now here you are seeing a filling defect. Now what are the causes of filling defect in the penile urethra? So let's enumerate them. Filling defect in a penile urethra. Now if the lesion is distal to the stricture, the possibility of blood clot are less. So what you have to go for? The consistency. The lesion has to be consistently there, not only in one film, but the all film it should be there. If possible, you ask patient to void and repeat the procedure. If the lesion are consistently seen, these are the sloughed out papillas, blood clots, benign polyps, transitional cell carcinoma or tuberculosis. So these are the possibilities. In other words, most of the things are common. Most of the things are common, that is benign. Benign lesions are not common in urethra. They are there but not common. This is again total stricture bulbous urethra. Stricture bulbous urethra. And now here it is interesting. Only narrowings are not stricture. And neode muscles, that is the compression of neode muscles, can cause an extensive compression which we are seeing clearly anteriorly, inserting or posteriorly. Now this has to be differentiated from a true stricture. Now note a focal smooth indentation, it will be smooth. It will be usually anterior, sometimes encircling. Then proximal bulbous urethra is the fixed site, that is the compressor neode muscles. Now in conclusion, first we are seeing the theoretical aspect, then the procedural detail, then a couple of films. Now we will come to the conclusive remark. Retrograde urethrography is undoubtedly a baseline investigation of choice to know etiology and morphology of the strictures. Due to its easy availability, low cost and being a OPD procedure, it's OPD procedure, patient walks in and walks out in same setting. Most common etiological factors are stricture, that is the post-inflammatory strictures. It works wonder in stricture urethra due to its sensitivity to detect anatomical segment in mold, number one. Then stricture length, stricture number, percentage of narrowing and coexisting pathologies. And we have also shown that it has got very good correlation between RGU done by radiology department and subsequently patient gets operated. We know the operative details, both can be correlated. Those who are interested can go to my original article and they will get the all details in it. Therefore, it is the investigation of choice in a patient suspected to have bladder outlet obstruction. How you suspect? Either clinically or by sonographically. Then this study gives urethral mapping and facilitates surgeon to plan their treatment. So that will give a good idea to the patient, to the surgeons, and also it will help patient to tell their recovery rates. Then whether patient can form conservatory line just a dilatation, if it is post-inflammatory, just antibiotics, or he is going to need some suture or other treatments, that will be decided by the surgeon. And this gives them a roadmap and basic ideas, so they prefer it. Herewith, we conclude our sessions. Now, I'm thankful for giving me your valuable time. It's most important for me that you are giving me your valuable time. Please note, Dharyavashi is not a race. It is not a number game. It's a process. Be a part of this process and enjoy the feast of knowledge. Now, I, Dr. Anil Joshi, log out this time with this information and we'll meet again in some different lecture series. Till then, take care, refer this as an investigation of choice for our bladder outlet obstructions, future urethra, do more studies, study more cases and do your best to the patients, give your best knowledge to the patient and let them get benefit of it.